Screen Time and Kids. The largest long-term study of brain development and child health in the United States is underway, and some of the analysis of screen time tied to that study has been recently shared publicly. You probably want to learn the impacts of the study found. Well, we'll dive into that in some of the preliminary report information shortly, but what's the role of online media for young people today? Melissa Dion, a mother of three, and Erica Scharrer of the University of Massachusetts at Amherst had lots to say about the issue.
It's a complicated question. You know, I think it's very hard these days to kind of extract the role of the media from other parts of life. They're so embedded. The average person spends almost 50% of their leisure time with various media. Average young person, it's
so
just
high to me.
Astronomical. It's astronomical. And these days, I think, you know, the idea of just turn it off, just pretend it's not happening, have your idea as a parent or a caregiver should be, we don't do this, is getting more and more unrealistic, unfortunately, you know, because it's just a part of breathing, alas and alack.
And you said 50% of adults, but that's for kids too, right?
It's for kids too.
So
it's for kids too.
50%
yes.
of your leisure time is spent in some sort of screen.
That's right. And an even more staggering statistic, and these are brand new data out in 2018 from U.S. teens 13 to 17 years old. We asked them, how much time do you spend with social media in particular? And 45% said, I'm on it nearly constantly.
Wow. So that's Instagram, that's Facebook, and things like that. And Melissa, you're a mom of three. Your kids are slightly younger, ages 6 to 12. But still, they're very interested in using some type of media. How have they approached you? Do you even have your six-year-old interested in using something?
More so like Messenger, and that's only to keep in contact with people because I will allow them to have full access to social medias yet because of their ages.
You won't, not quite yet. No. And so they each have a tablet, as I understand it, right? Yes. But you've talked with them a lot about the parameters around that. Have they, and you keep some pretty stringent parental controls, right?
I do.
And how have you set those up?
I did a lot of research and figured out how to do it all, even on YouTube, because I had to block, because my kids would rather watch YouTube than the television. So I had to learn how to block certain things, activities, and I do go in and check their history all the time and make sure they're not doing things they're not supposed to do.
And so do you talk openly about that and say, hey, look, here are the rules around this, and I'm going to check X, Y, and Z?
All the time.
And what do they say when you say that?
I know, Mommy, and so I think they know not to go and look at different things at this point, but they are also 6 to 12.
So, Professor, when you're teaching around this concept of media to people who are slightly older than teenagers, but they're still in their young 20s, what's the discussion like about how media and social media is used today among them and their peers?
Yeah, I think that my college students at UMass and elsewhere, and as well as the national data about teenagers in general, really show that young people are pretty torn about the role of social media and cell phones in their lives. They recognize a lot of positives, and there are a lot of positives. The connectivity is extraordinary. They use it to connect with family members, people, you know, abroad or far away, or military, you know, parents. So the connectivity is amazing and wonderful, but they also recognize real drawbacks. And so, you know, sometimes they wish that they didn't grow up in such a media saturated life. And they do know that, you know, there are disadvantages as well. And the biggest one that they list, as well as what researchers are interested in, is encountering, you know, meanness and nastiness and bullying online. And the recent statistics on that show just about 40% of young people have encountered bullying online.
Yeah,
it's getting so
that
common.
We've seen that as a real challenge here in Massachusetts, where laws have been passed,
yes,
around keeping kids away from bullying or punishment for bullying and things like that. And Melissa, you're a nurse at an area school. What are kids discussing about ways they're being in contact through social media? Does it come up at school often?
It does, because most things get put on social media by the students, just like many people at home. But the students, they come to me and talk to me about things that they saw on social media that happened, whether outside the school or in their community, and it bothers them.
Good and bad?
Yeah, absolutely. Yes.
Yeah. So there's this sense that there's just 24/7 broadcasting of personal details sometimes?
Yes.
Yeah. I know that there's a National Institute of Health is in the midst of a new study, a larger study, and there's been some reporting about various small aspects. And I'll have us talk a little bit about it, but I want the folks at home to know the full study has yet to be published. But there was a recent finding, and this, like I said, is part of that larger study, and it found two different things. One was that greater social media use, and we're talking about Instagram or Facebook or things like that, was associated with some positive effects, increased physical activity and less family conflict and fewer sleep problems. And then on the other side, the study found that kids who use general media, they call it like whether that's TV, the internet, video games, reported that they were prone to having worse sleep and more family conflict. What do you make of this information?
I think it's really early days to put too much credence in these new data. I mean, first of all, we have to read the study in its entirety, and it has yet to, you know, appear in print. Exactly. But, you know, I think it's really interesting. And my own reading of the research literature is that, yes, you can find positive effects. It's not a one-sided story. You know, there are absolutely some real advantages to living with these devices for us as adults and for young people as well. The sleep thing is interesting. There's a lot of research these days about sleep and how screens in general can disturb sleep. And most of that really seems to point in the direction that a screen lit up with the blue light in front of your face right before you go to sleep and all of the emotions and thoughts and feelings it can register for you is probably going to be disruptive to your sleep and not necessarily a boon to your sleep, which these data seem to have found. So I'd really like to dissect these data once they're published, but we can't do that quite yet.
Melissa, have you been able to sift through and see, like, okay, if the kids are using Facebook or Instagram, or if the kids are playing video games, do you notice a difference in either the way they react or mood or things like that? I know it's digging a little deep.
Well, with my 12-year-old, we had to cut off electronics at 8 o'clock at night, because if not, then he's going to be up half the night. And so when we decrease his electronics at 8 o'clock, which, again, is a lot of YouTube and stimulation, then he's sleeping a lot better.
You found that. You did see that connection
yes.
for you.
Yep.
Interesting.
And to go back to that idea of family conflict, that I can absolutely see. You know, I do think that people use these devices to tell folks when they're going to be home, you know, set expectations about, you know, I'm staying late at so-and-so's house, maybe even work through some thorny problems. One of my sisters, her son would share things with her through text that he wouldn't say to her face-to-face just because it was really sensitive for him. So I can see how family conflict would maybe, you know, in some circumstances be, you know, helped in some way by some of these tools.
How do you as a parent balance or help your kids balance the use of social media, the use of screens in general? Do you talk about that?
I basically just tell them, you know, you have to have a break for now because it is, they explain that it is too much for their brain, that it's overstimulation. You know, I'm very open with my kids. I let them know why I'm doing things. I don't just take things away from them. So I explain, you know, your mind needs to rest right now. Go read a book, go unwind.
Outside. Yes, yeah, do something else.
Yes.
Make something else.
Exactly.
How about for you as a professor in the classroom? What is that? What's it like?
It's really distracting. It really is. You know, and I try to say, you know, I didn't really get into this profession to kind of police the students. It's the last thing I want to do. But when I walk around, you know, people's, you know, instant messages are pinging off and I see something on their screen that has nothing to do with the topic in class. And, you know, I think you do have to say, you have to check these devices at the door, unless you're going to use them as a tool during the class for some kind of information gathering. But yeah, it's really increasingly, again, it's just sort of, you know, I don't even think the students are that sheepish about it. You know, it's pretty brazen. That's just how they live their lives. And so the phone is there and it's going off lots and lots. It lights up. It's got messages. Of course, it's going to capture their attention for at least part of our 75 minutes together at a time.
Well, I appreciate you coming in today to have a chat. Thanks so much.